Welcome back to The Rush. If you don't know what a transmedia producer is, you are about to find out.
Yeah, he is at the top of the business. His name is Jeff Gomez. He is the CEO of Starlight Entertainment. Hello, how are you?
All right, doing okay.
Okay,
before
we knew you were coming on, I had heard about transmedia producer before once or twice, but I didn't actually know what it was. But I will leave the explanation up to you. What do you do?
Okay, it's actually the funnest job in the world. A transmedia producer is someone who comes in an intellectual property, a story world, and defends and protects it as it moves across multiple media platforms.
Your life is a video game.
Yeah,
isn't
we're,
it?
We're talking movies, games, graphic novels, toys. I mean,
absolutely every conceivable media platform, digital and traditional.
So let's take Men in Black as an example, and tell us what you did as a transmedia producer for Men in Black.
Awesome. It was just so awesome. This is a situation where the studio, Sony Pictures, they have this amazing universe. And they've made a few movies out of it. But what people don't realize is that the universe is so rich and dense, and there are so many characters. There's huge potential for video games, comic books, novels, just everything. And our job was to kind of create this mythology, which this is a huge document that kind of is a blueprint, a guideline to the entire Men in Black universe.
So when you say, like, protect the franchise, I mean, you mean it. You when I talked to you earlier and when I talk to you now, what comes across more than any other thing is how much you care about the story and how much you care about the character and how much you care about the viability of what this actually is that they're creating.
When I was a kid, I wondered about different aspects of universes like Star Wars or any of these big science fiction movies, and I asked myself questions that sometimes I never got the answers to. Nowadays, you need to be able to create hours and hours of content out of these huge $200 or $300 million franchises in order to get a good return on investment. And so you need high quality content. We've all played crummy video game adaptations of movies.
Disappointing, right?
It's unacceptable.
Well, let's talk about, you came from the video game business. You also worked with Halo. So maybe you can tell us what you did with Halo in your work.
Could you imagine? I get to work in the greatest sandboxes in all of popular culture. Halo is so cool because you have a big smash hit video game that is super successful on one media platform. Yeah. But what would a Halo novel be like? What would a Halo graphic novel be like, or a movie, or things like that? Sometimes the storytelling on different media platforms is very different, and you want to play to the strengths of each media platform. So what we do is show the game developer how cool it would be for these characters to operate in different ways and tell different kinds of stories on these platforms.
You are essentially, and your business, I guess, is essentially being a storyteller and a creator and a co-creator.
It all starts with story, absolutely.
Mm-hmm. So let's talk about Pirates of the Caribbean. What did you do with that franchise?
Well, here you had something that was kind of a surprise hit for the Walt Disney Company. So as they ramped up to the second and third movies, they needed to kind of, it was so rich and dense, this universe, almost kind of hard to understand for the layperson. We had to go in and figure out who this Jack Sparrow character really was and what his...
What led him to be
You're
Jack Sparrow?
You're a psychologist,
Sparrow.
A little bit, yeah.
You kind of have to sit and... So when you create this mythology, whether it be Men in Black or Pirates, is it a document that you create with the writers? Do you give it to? Like, where does it go? Do the actors see it?
Again, tremendous fun, because we get to work with the heads of the studios, the directors of the films, the screenwriters, and we're absorbing huge amounts of information. My company has got 10 people that it's their job to absorb everything about these amazing fantasy universes and then document them in these massive mythology documents.
And this is really applicable, I mean, to a lot of different industries as we move forward and as technology branches off in different directions and the way we communicate branches off in different directions. How important is this message to other businesses when they're participating in other mediums to tell their story?
That's a superb observation. Brands in companies all over the world need to be communicated nowadays through narrative. The age of the 30-second commercial or the print ad, it's kind of fading. Yeah. We need to establish dialogue between our story worlds or our brands and people, because everyone now is capable of broadcasting.
And that dialogue and that style of dialogue has to change for each medium, doesn't it? Because that's what I see now sometimes, is that they take that message that they're developing in this area and they try and jam it onto another way of communicating.
You can't just repeat things anymore. You have to customize your message and your narrative to the features that are the strongest on each media platform, whether it's mobile or a tablet or the web or social media.
I think consumers have gotten smarter too, so this mythology becomes more and more important. I mean, when you're working with films, we've discussed that, video games, but how do you work with toys? How do you enrich that environment?
Wow. It all falls down to the essence of the brand or the story world. My team goes in and asks thousands of questions of our clients so that we understand what makes these brands unique and distinct and what story they're telling to the consumer. Once we understand that, we have kind of the bones upon which to flesh out a story. We've done this with Coca-Cola and Happiness Factory and all kinds of consumer brands.
How do you work with Coca-Cola?
Well, there were these commercials called Happiness Factory about these animated characters who were building a bottle of Coca-Cola. That was 30 seconds long, but Coke came to us and said, what would a universe be like with these characters? And how can we continue to, because it was so popular, spread the message of the Happiness Factory, which is about innocence and about the deliciousness of Coca-Cola, but also about adventure and the spirit to quest and make the world a happier place.
So do you like your job at all? I mean, is there any enjoyment? You must see this stuff. I mean, obviously the videos and the toys and the other elements of a franchise, you must see them years before the public.
Could you imagine working on Avatar 2 or 3 years before it comes out and not being able to tell the world that the most amazing movie of all time is under construction?
So is there going to be another Avatar?
Another couple of avatars.
Yeah, I can imagine. So you must be a very popular man with nieces, nephews, cousins, whoever it is. I mean, to be able to come over to your house and play video games before anyone else.
There are times where we get in game consoles that are not even on the market yet with video games. And once in a while, we bring the kids in to test out the games
Lucky
that are not
kids.
Coming out
can
for
Can I
months.
Be one of those kids that comes in?
All right, all right.
Thank you so much.
Jeff,
if you want
amazing.
To find out more about what Jeff does, you can go to his website. It's on the screen for you right now. We're going to take a quick break.